I've read the fiery gospel written burnished rows of steel. As you deal with my condemner, so with you my grace shall deal. Let the hero born of woman crush the serpent with his heel, since God is marching on.
All right, welcome to Christian Overcomers, and thank you for joining us for this live broadcast. Today we're going to talk about the 2016 election, and we're going to title this Americanism versus Globalism, because that's really what this whole election is about. People try to make it about Donald Trump and say they don't like his character and things like that, but they're missing the big picture. Everything that Donald Trump's been saying has been Americanism versus globalism, which is what Hillary Clinton represents. And I'm going to get a quote here from Donald Trump on that. Those of you on YouTube, you'll see this on your slide, but those of you live, I'll just read it out loud here. Donald Trump, in one of his speeches, said the most, I think this was his acceptance speech as the nominee for the Republican Party. He said the most important difference between our plan and that of our opponents is that our plan will put America first. Americanism, now check this out, Americanism, not globalism, will be our credo. In other words, that's our whole mission. That's what our whole campaign is about, Americanism versus globalism. Now I'm going to pull up Hillary Clinton's quote from her meeting with the, or secret meeting with a Brazilian bank, excuse me. And pull that up here. All right, this is what she said. My dream, Hillary Clinton, my dream is a hemispheric common market with open trade and open borders. Sometime in the future, with energy that is as green and sustainable as we can get, powering growth and opportunity for every person in the hemisphere. So she said her dream is for open trade and open borders. That's globalism. That's what globalists always talk about. No walls, no borders, no countries. And we'll talk about a song here in a little bit that really lays out the whole globalist agenda. Many of you have probably heard that song. So anyways, I guess we'll ask ourselves this question, because some people might not know what globalism is. They say somebody that hasn't studied the Bible that long, or somebody who doesn't get into politics that much, might say, well, what's wrong with globalism? Don't we all want to get together as one and be nice to each other and trade with each other and things like that? Well, if that was all it was all about, then yeah, I mean, in a sense, that wouldn't be bad. But we know from Revelation chapter 13, I'm going to pull it up here from Blue Letter Bible, that there's such a thing. Well, globalism in this chapter is described as a multi-headed beast that conquers the world and is a symbol of a great tyranny. So though it looks good right now, that's how they sell it to many people. And if you're losing jobs in America, and if you've worked in one of the industries that have lost their jobs to NAFTA, whether it was the car industry, the steel industry, or whatever, my dad used to work in, he was a machinist. He'd make machined metal parts. And since NAFTA was passed by Bill Clinton, that industry that he used to work in has been decimated. He even tried to start his own business doing it, had his own machinery, and just to find out later on that everything was now being shipped out to China. So that's one example of why globalism is bad for America. So I'm going to read Revelation 13, verse 1. It says, "And I stood upon the sand of the sea, and I saw a beast rise up out of the sea, having seven heads and 10 horns, and upon his horns, 10 crowns, and upon his heads, the name of blasphemy." So here we got this one world government, so-called, the kingdom of the Antichrist rising up out of, he's seeing a vision rising up out of the sea, and it's getting ready to conquer the world. And what does it have on it? The names of blasphemy. That means that this global system here that's described here as a multi-headed beast that Hillary Clinton is working for when she talks about a world without borders and it takes a village and all these other things, she's trying to help give power to this beast by supporting it, by passing legislation to promote it and so forth.
One of the WikiLeaks that was just released was showing how Hillary and I don't remember the specific person, but their correspondence was about kind of hating on Catholics and religious people.
Right.
And I mean, right there just tells you that she's heading down the wrong path when she's trying to attack Christians and Christian believers.
Yeah, and you brought up the Catholics thing. What was really interesting, many of you might have seen this, but both Hillary Clinton and Donald Trump last week were invited to this, I guess they do it every presidential election, some Catholic charity where they were raising right. money. But it was all the high up political elites. There was like Henry Kissinger back there. I mean, this was the world elites in this room. The media, the owners of the different media stations were there, CBS, NBC, ABC, all of them, all of them like in this one room. And Donald Trump gets on and he makes some of his jokes, but then he made some serious statements that were needed. I mean, here we got Hillary Clinton in here at a Catholic charity when she's, she hates Christians, yeah. Catholics. And that's what Donald Trump said in his speech. He said, and Hillary's sitting here pretending she loves you guys, but she hates Catholics. And he was so spot on. I mean, it was so refreshing. And then during that speech, he started calling out the heads of the media that were there and said that they were working to elect crooked Hillary. And he starts pointing his fingers. He says, yeah, there's the heads of ABC back there, NBC and so forth. I mean, and here he is in the room. It almost reminded me of like maybe Samson in the temple of the Philistines. And he's just going there to push it down. And that's like that's what Donald Trump was doing. And the looks on some of the faces back there, they were just, almost fearful of this man. You have one man going against the entire establishment, one man backed by we the people. But nevertheless, it was like one man going against them all. And who would have the courage to do that? I mean, I just couldn't see myself having the courage to do something like that. But wow, I mean, it was amazing.
Yeah, and if you're not paying attention and to all these different things going on, you don't see any of this. You don't hear right. any of it.
And so that's what, we're talking about this beast here. It's what we see going on with the Democrat Party and the corruption and the collusion with the media and so forth. What they're trying to do is they're trying to divide and conquer. They're trying to consolidate power. That's what one worldism is all about. Get everybody to get on board and say this is such a wonderful thing. But once all that power is consolidated, it's going to be handed over to the Antichrist. And that's the part that most people don't see or realize when they're working for it. Well, I wouldn't doubt, what Hillary Clinton actually, there was some of her, I think it was a state trooper that was in charge of her security team while she was in Arkansas when Bill Clinton was the governor there. She used to go off to California to some witches covenant that was happening every month. So, she was literally participating in witchcraft and God knows what. So, I mean, it's demonic.
Wow. Definitely.
And globalism at its core is demonic in nature. And we'll talk about that probably in a little bit, show some scriptures of why that's so. But bottom line, up to this point, when you look at the speeches, when you look at Trump's speeches and you look at Hillary's, it's globalist. It's Trump is against the New World Order, the satanic New World Order, and Hillary is for the satanic New World Order. So if you're a Christian and you're on the fence and you just don't like Donald Trump, you say he's crude, he's misbehaved, he talks rough. If that alone, I mean, as a Christian, you should be able to make a determination that alone is good. I mean, that he's against the biggest source of evil is one worldism that sets up the stage for the Antichrist.
Yeah, if you're a Christian and you're voting for Hillary, I have some serious doubts about your faith.
I mean,
everything from abortion to anti-God. I saw a clip at one of Hillary's rallies, and the lady said, she was saying the, or what was it, the Pledge of Allegiance, or she's, but she's like, one nation under, and she caught herself.
Right.
And then she said, indivisible with, and Hillary was just laughing and thought it was the funniest thing, and the crowd was clapping and cheering, right. And I mean, right there, it's just so obvious that we're dealing with, it's not just politics.
Right.
We're talking about a deep spiritual battle.
And I'm glad you brought that up, because Hillary's people can't say one nation under God.
Yeah.
But Trump went even further, and he's been doing this in a lot of his speeches. I've seen it in several different ones. So it wasn't like he was just pandering to Christians. I think one of the ones that I saw it on, he was talking to Christians, but I've seen it where he was talking to just the normal crowds in the stadium. And I'm going to quote it here. It's on our website if you want to check it out at christianovercomers.com. I have this quote here and the video of him saying it. It's wonderful. But he says, let me see where I have it here. It's on the back here. He says, imagine what our country could accomplish if we started working together as one people under one God, saluting one flag. I mean, I don't even think Ted Cruz would have the courage to say one God. He might say under God, but when you say one God, that upsets liberals, it'll upset the Muslims and so forth. Because just prior to him reading this quote or saying this line here, he was just got done reading from the epistles of John.
Yeah.
1 John chapter 4 about God's love being in us and coming out of us, and it's a witness that we are of God. And he said that's what he's trying to do. That's his campaign. He said he reads that verse often, 1 John chapter 4. I can't remember the exact verse. But he says that he reads that verse often, and that is what he's trying to do with to have Americans love one another. In the right way, not love your enemy who's trying to destroy you. Obviously, he's very good at fighting back when it comes to them.
Yeah, you just played that video for me, and I hadn't seen that yet.
Right.
And I try to pay attention and stay in touch with what's going on. I had never seen that quote.
Right.
You're not going to see it unless you dig in and pay attention.
Yeah, and that one quote alone should be the mission of every Christian. Every Christian patriot, that one line there, one people under one God, saluting one flag, that is the definition of nationalism or Americanism. More than that, it's more than nationalism, because it includes God. And that is what the globalists don't want. That one line is what they absolutely hate, especially because they want division among our people. They don't want us all worshiping the same God. They don't want us to be a Christian nation. And as we can see with these NFL stars lately, some of them, they're trying to desecrate the national anthem and our flag. So they're trying to attack the very foundations of what Trump is actually trying to build up. Again, whether you love him, hate him, like him, or whatever, that's what he's doing. What he's done in the past, yeah, hey, we're all sinners. I mean, what bothers me a lot is when you have the Pharisaic attitude,
right,
of people saying, well, I'll never stand behind that man. He's nothing but a pig and all this stuff. It's like, how many of those people have skeletons in their closet?
That's the perfect people speaking.
Right. I mean, you look at who Jesus, I was talking to Damien about this earlier, and I mentioned this before in one of our videos. If we were to judge character, use that as our number one thing besides policy, we would say that King David couldn't have been king, and virtually every king that God had chosen before could not be king. I say we ought
to... Moses?
Moses, yeah. Moses was a pagan, yeah. and killed an Egyptian before he had become, before God had picked him and chose him. I mean, you hypocrites out there. I mean, it just is so frustrating when you're dealing with these people, because they think they're so clean and they're so perfect. Anyways, yeah, David was guilty of adultery and murder of Uriah. I mean, it was a very bad thing. So for us, if we were to judge him, we'd say, no way could he be king. But God looked upon David's heart, knew that he loved the people. He cared for the people, even though he was a sinner to the extreme when it came to that. And I think Donald Trump is similar in some regards to David, in that I really see a sincere love for America, a sincere love for his supporters. And why do you think he has such a great support? It's because there's a love, there's a bond between the people and Donald Trump, and Donald Trump's doing things that these sissy Republicans refused to do for so long, and they've been allowing us to be conquered by the globalists. I'll mention this since we're talking about it, but you know, a lot of us supported, because they were Republicans, a lot of us supported George Bush, George H.W. Bush, as well as George W. Bush. But when you look at the policies that they instituted and the things they were for, they were globalists. I mean, they were helping support this beast. George H.W. Bush talked about it in his speech. I'm going to pull up a quote here in a second. And George W. Bush tried to do it when he wanted to spread democracy throughout the Middle East, as though if we just gave them a taste of freedom that they would accept it and we'd have this great world, utopia, a great grand democracy. And so they each were globalists in their own way. And Jeb Bush was as well. And it was, that's why I actually enjoyed watching Donald Trump. Maybe this is wrong, unchristian of me to say this, but I enjoyed watching Donald Trump really beat Jeb Bush down because I did not want to see another Bush, especially Jeb Bush. I mean,
right.
He was so, just so bad in my opinion.
I don't think honesty is an anti-Christian trait. You're being honest.
Right. So I got a slide up here for the YouTubers. A picture of Barack Obama, of all the living presidents today, Barack Obama, George W. Bush, Bill Clinton, George H.W. Bush, and Jimmy Carter. They all have one thing in common, and that is they were all globalists. Now, I'm not saying they were evil intention. A lot of people are globalists simply because they're deceived. They get this ideology in their mind, and they turn it into idolatry. It's easy to, it can slip up on people and blind them to what they're doing. I mean, think about it. In their mind, like George H.W. Bush and George W. Bush, they're not probably thinking, now maybe they are, but I don't think they were thinking, oh, this is an evil thing we're going to do for the people, like some of the behind the scenes guys, you know, some of the people that were influencing them in these doctrines or whatever, or these ideologies. I think some of these guys, like the Bushes, probably thought it was good for the people that we do this. You know, you can decide for yourself, but nevertheless, they were all globalists, and the Bushes actually helped destroy the original conservative movement, in that after the Bushes came into power, you had something that's called, I don't know if you've heard this term, I'm sure you have, the neocons, mm-hmm. which means new conservative. And in other words, really what it boils down to is conservatism became globalism. So neocon, basically, it means you're a globalist who has some, you know, conservative internal policies, but you're still working outside to build this grand utopia. And that's what guys like Pat Buchanan were against. And Pat, when you look at it, Donald Trump really is supporting virtually identically the policies that Pat Buchanan stood for. Pat Buchanan was a conservative that ran for president way back a few cycles ago. But Pat Buchanan was very unsuccessful in getting the message out, whereas Donald Trump is a unique character where he's able to get the message out to the people at a unique time, because now people are seeing it. But Pat Buchanan had it right all along, and that was really interesting to see. Oh, I was going to get the quote here from George Bush here about the New World Order. So George Bush, H.W. Bush, he says, 100 generations have searched for this elusive path to peace, while 1,000 wars raged across a span of human endeavor. Today, that new world is struggling to be born. A world quite different from the one we've known. A world where the rule of law supplants the rule of the jungle. A world in which nations recognize the shared responsibility for freedom and justice. Now, up to this point, you could say, well, that doesn't sound so bad. Well, let's see who who he wants to give the power to. I'm going to pull it up right here. All right. He continues on. We have before us the opportunity to forge for ourselves and for future generations a new world order. A world where the rule of law, not the rule of the jungle, governs the conduct of nations. When we are successful, and he says, and we will be, we have a real chance at this new world order. An order in which, now here's the key here, an order in which a credible United Nations can use its peacekeeping role to fulfill the promise and vision of the UN's founders. Now, if anybody has done any research at all on the United Nations, you'll find it stems right back to Satanism and all of the different evil things that the Bible talks about, the anti-Christianism, you name it. And here he wants to basically forfeit our power over to the United Nations. And this is wrong in another sense, in that way back in Genesis chapter 11, I'm going to pull it up from Blue Letter Bible. If you have your Bibles, please open up there. Genesis chapter 11. And Genesis 11 was about the Tower of Babel. And you remember, I'm just going to read a few verses here. It says in the Genesis 11 verse 1. It says, and the whole earth was of one language and one speech, one worldism, globalism, right here. It happened before. And it came to pass as they journeyed from the east that they found a plain in the land of Shinar, and they dwelt there. And one said to another, go, let us make a brick and burn them thoroughly. And they had brick for stone and slime they had for mortar. And they said, go to, let us build us a city and a tower whose top may reach unto heaven, and let us make us a name, lest we be scattered abroad upon the face of the whole earth. That's basically identical if you compare what George Bush said there. This is what he was saying. Let us get together. Let's have a name. Let's have this rule of law. Let's have a whole world order. That's exactly what happened way back here in Genesis 11. So, what we've learned, what many of us have, many of us saw this, you know, years ago, but what's come out in the open since Trump has come along, is that we've realized that Republicans and Democrats are often virtually the same thing, just presented as a different flavor. They both work, they are both globalists, and they just seem to govern differently internally. But at the end of the day, they're working for the same goal, to build a city and a tower, to build Babylon, to build the Tower of Babel. And then what happens? God says, and the Lord came down to see the city and the tower, which the children of men builded. And the Lord said, now check this out, behold, the people is one. They are the United Nations. And they have all one language. And this they begin to do, and now nothing will be restrained from them, which they have imagined to do. Now, I want you to key in on that word imagine, because I have lyrics of a song I want to read for you in a minute. And Donald Trump had a different thing that he imagined. He said, imagine if Americans worked, imagine what our country could accomplish if we started working together as one people under one God, saluting one flag. Now, he was talking about Americanism. That's fine for a country to do that, to be unified, to have a national purpose, especially if they're unified under Almighty God. But there's a different thing people want to, the globalists want to imagine. They want to imagine a one world government where humans find their own salvation, their own utopia, and their own heaven on earth, so to speak. So God says, let us go down and there confound their speech, or confound their language, that they may not understand one another's speech. So the Lord scattered them abroad abroad from thence upon the face of the earth, and they left off to build the city. Now he goes on and he says, Therefore is the name of it called Babel, because the Lord did there confound the language of all the earth, and from thence did the Lord scatter them abroad upon the face of the earth. So in other words, God did not want the nations of the world. He remember in Genesis 10, he actually separated the sons of Noah and wanted them to be separate nations with boundaries and so forth, inheritances and places. And now they're trying to rebel against God, come together and build their own Babylonian system, their own world system, and ignore God as the creator and say, well, we humans can do it. It's, you know, and all this type of stuff.
You're on a roll.
Yeah.
But I was, when you were reading that, I was thinking, back then they all spoke one language at the Tower of Babel, and God said, enough's enough, and put all these different languages so that they couldn't collude together. And, well, if you think about it, what's the language today? Everybody speaks English.
Right.
In every country, it's the universal language.
It is.
So we're almost back to the Tower of Babel, where we're all speaking the same language. There isn't that boundaries anymore.
Right. That's a good point. And from New York City, which is interesting, Donald Trump's from there, but he's against it. You know, it's just like, that's kind of how Samson was. He was raised up to, had him marry the Philistine. It was all God's purpose to be right there next to the Philistine so he could push him down. And Donald Trump has been in New York in the center of Mystery Babylon, so to speak. And he's trying to tear it down. I want to read a quote here actually from Donald Trump about this movement, nationalism, and the movement that Trump's leading right now is a great threat to the world system. That's why the media is attacking him. That's why the Republican establishment attacked him. And that's why they're trying everything they can to stop him, because if he succeeds in what he's doing, their plans and their operations that they've been working for so long is going to either be delayed or destroyed for some time. And they don't want that to happen. Anyways, he says, for those who control the levers of power in Washington and for the global special interests, they partner with these people that don't have your good in mind. Our campaign represents a true exidential, how do you say that word again? This one right here.
I think you said it right.
Okay, I think I said it right. I always have a tongue twister on that, and I wasn't sure if I said it right.
Oh, that's right.
Threat like they have never seen before. In other words, he says, our campaign represents a true threat that they've never seen before. That's why they're going bonkers. That's why they're going crazy. That's why every single mainstream media outlet is, you know, trying everything they can to destroy him, destroy his character. And then you have Christians, again, I'm going to bring them up again, the Never Trumpers, that go along with that. I mean, that alone, you should say to yourself, if you're a Christian with any knowledge at all about the Bible and the New World Order, you should say, hey, wait a minute, Satan's attacking this man. Like, I've never seen a man attacked before. Maybe he's doing something right. Maybe he's doing something that's upsetting Satan. You know, but I guess the depth of their knowledge isn't very deep.
Yeah, we were talking earlier before we were live here, and I love Glenn Beck. I think he does great things, but I'm so frustrated with him right now and his stance, because he's, you know, a Christian, and he's it's all about the morality of it and his conscience and all that. But when it comes down to it, he's leading people away from globalism versus Americanism. He's if a vote for not for Trump is a vote for Hillary, and I'm just so disappointed in him. I mean, I still like him. I still think he's a great asset to our country, but I'm very disappointed in his stance right now.
Yeah, I would agree with you. You know, it was when he first came out on Fox News, he was on CNN for a while, and he was just a joker guy. But then he got on Fox News, and he was actually exposing globalism.
Yeah.
Which was weird. And now it's like he's done a total flip-flop.
He's not getting it. He's not. Yeah. Like, what you're sharing is convincing me, too.
Yeah.
And he's not, I don't even think Donald Trump realizes what he's doing.
Right.
You know, the spiritual side of it.
Right.
Although from the quotes you're reading and the scriptures you're reading, it sure sounds like God is possibly using him right now to keep our country together, the Christians, healthy, so that maybe there's one last push to call all the Christians one more time before the globalism happens, because it's inevitable.
Yeah.
You know, we were talking about it earlier is there anything we can really do to stop it? You know, it's prophetic.
Right.
It's biblical that this is going to happen.
Yeah.
So do we just let it happen, or do we fight against it?
That's a good point. And that's where a lot of people, I've had some people say, well, Pastor Ben, you're going against God's plan because you're trying to stop it from happening. Well, the thing is we have to, you know, God's plan is going to come to pass, but we each have individual duties. And one of our individual duties is to stand the gap, to expose evil, to expose corruption, to try to call the nation to repentance like Daniel did in Daniel chapter 9. So the way I look at it, and even when this new world order arises, who's fighting it? You read about it in Revelation chapter 12. It's those that keep the commandments of God and have the testimony of Jesus Christ. So we are supposed to fight this thing all the way out. God's word will come to pass, but we're still fighting it. We're still speaking against the new world order. We're still trying to stop it because that's what we're called to do.
Speak the truth.
Yeah, and that actually will, this is a big thing, is people will, if you don't stand against it, you're missing an opportunity to reach souls that otherwise wouldn't be reached. Because these souls are touched by, let's say somebody lost their job, they were a coal miner or something like that, and they lost their job due to policies by the globalists. They're in a perfect opportunity to hear the truth when you say, hey, guess what? This system was written about all along. This is New World Order. It's ultimately Satan's end game plan. And that's why you're suffering. And then they can see the truth. If you just sit back and say, I'm going to watch the show, I want the end to happen. It might not happen for a generation or two after your time. And you just wasted your entire opportunity to plant a seed with somebody to give them the truth. And that's why I'm so adamantly against the sit and wait, and that it's prophecy, it's going to happen. Because it's also prophecy, like I said before, that we are supposed, that
stand
the saints
against.
Will fight. Yeah. So ultimately, when it gets to it, and let's say it's obvious, God lets us know that, hey, don't go past, don't take up arms and try to defeat
the
beast.
The Antichrist is here.
Yeah, the Antichrist
peace is
here.
Upon us.
Right. And then we'll go into a different mode. But until then, I want to fight for my kids. My kids and their grandkids' future, because what if our forefathers, the American forefathers, thought the end was in their time, and they said, no, we're just going to sit back and watch the show, let God deal with it. I mean, that's, we wouldn't even have America today. And here's another thing. I just lost my train of thought on that, but there was another verse, I was trying to think of it. Here we go. Remember when the Israelites were delivered out of Egypt by Moses, God using Moses to deliver the Israelites. His plan was going to come to pass, right? His plan for the Israelites was that they enter into the promised land, that they can defeat the enemies and they subdue that land. But the people still had to fight the battles. Just as today, we win this war. So we don't ever stop fighting. I mean, imagine if the people there were saying, well, God delivered us from Egypt. He promised us the promised land. And now we're just going to sit back and do nothing.
That's a great
no,
point.
No, God uses people to perform his work. That argument, I've had a lot of people email me that in the past saying, you're trying to stop God's plan and so forth. I'd like to qualify and say, you're not performing the commandments that God told you to perform. I mean, there was the commandment of the lazy servant, the unprofitable servant in the book of Matthew. I think it's Matthew 25, if I remember right, where Jesus talked about this servant that wasn't doing any work. And Jesus said, occupy or work until I come. So our mission in our mind, our mindset should be, We fight, we work hard, we do everything we can to try to plant seeds, save souls, until our last breath. Do you agree?
I completely agree. And I think along with that, with the whole global thing, not to get sidetracked, I'm not going to go there, but the whole global warming and climate change thing is kind of forcing this global initiative.
Right.
You know, where everybody's uniting to save the Earth.
Yeah.
When I was just reading in Genesis, the Noah story, and at the end of all that, God said clearly that I will never destroy the Earth again until, you know, the end.
Mm-hmm.
There will always be winter. There will always be summer. There will always be seasons.
Right.
He will not let that happen again. So it's the atheists, it's the non-believers that think that this global warming initiative is so important and it's tying us all together as a nation and a world. I think that's a huge part of Satan's agenda, is to make people believe that we're destroying the Earth and God isn't in control. There isn't a God, even though God said clearly in Genesis that there will never be, will never destroy the Earth again. There will always be winter. There will always be summer. There will always be the seasons.
Yeah, yeah, because that goes, that totally says global warming you're right. It's not going to, nothing man can do is going to stop that from happening because God promised it.
Right, exactly. But it's tying us all. We're signing these treaties or these documents that are putting us in line to just hurt our energy system, hurt our economy, all in the name of saving the Earth.
Right.
And pulling us into this global structure that says we all need to, you know, hurt our economies and hurt the third world countries. Don't let them get any fossil fuels. Don't let them have, you know, the same things we have.
Yeah.
Because it's killing our Earth. And it's just a big scam. And it's very frustrating to me.
That you brought up an excellent point. It made me think of a scripture here. I'm going to pull it up here. Revelation 13, because really what it's all these, they're idols.
Yeah.
Satan's creating all these different idols in people's mind. One idol is we can join together and save the Earth. That's an idol. It might not be something you visibly fall down and worship, but if it's what you serve.
The Church of Environmentalism.
Yeah. That, and if it's over and above what you're doing for God, and you're serving that as your main unifying purpose instead of saying, hey, the gospel is our unifying purpose, and by the way, we should, you know, try to keep the Earth clean. And
right, like Rhonda said here, she just mentioned that we are to be good stewards, of course. I mean,
right.
I'm so against pollution and littering and ruining our Earth and keeping our water clean. I'm all for that, but they're taking it to the next level, which is another step to globalism.
Right, they're hijacking, you know, it is a good thing to, like Rhonda was saying, to be good stewards and not to be wasteful and destructive.
Absolutely.
But they hijack a good cause and make it into an idol, and then people worship that cause rather than just saying, well, that might be one of God's laws, that you're not supposed to destroy the Earth. You're supposed to take care of your farm fields by not overplanting them, spilling all kinds of, you know, poisonous fertilizer in there and stuff like that.
Yep.
And I'm going to read a verse about this beast again here in Revelation chapter 13. Eventually when the Antichrist gets here, it talks about how the whole world will be deceived. And then it says in verse 15 of Revelation 13, it says, and he had power to give life unto the image of the beast, an image, you know, it's like an idol, that the image of the beast should both speak and cause that as many as would not worship the image of the beast should be killed. Now, in the Old Testament, images were actually literal physical things that people fell down and worshipped. I don't know if this is going to be a literal physical image or not, or if it's trying to teach us a spiritual lesson. But nevertheless, they've made an idol out of this beast, this one world government, or even, I believe, the Antichrist himself. And so the Antichrist is going to be saying all these good things and trying to unite the world together. And so forth.
Yeah, I think the word hijacking is the key word. They take things that in and of themselves are good or true,
right?
But they turn them into something that is ultimately evil and pushing towards, again, globalism, like our topic.
Yeah, and I mentioned the word imagine earlier. There's a song by John Lennon. Many of you are probably familiar with it. It's called Imagine. Now, remember, Donald Trump imagined the right thing. I mean, he was right in line with the first commandment of God. One people under one God. That's the first commandment that he was promoting. He said, wouldn't it be great? We'd be unstoppable. And that's biblically true. God tells us that if we want to be great again, we have to follow his commandments and obey him. And the first commandment's the most important thing. So it is only God that can make America great again. And that's when if we did exactly what Donald Trump said here, imagine what our country could accomplish if we started working together as one people under one God, saluting one flag. If we did that, we would be unstoppable. We would be great again. That was fantastic. I mean, I was, singing for joy for about a day after I heard him give that speech. I couldn't believe it. I was showing my wife. I was like, you gotta hear this. I can't believe it. A presidential candidate, anyways, had the guts to say one God. You know what that tells you? It tells you we don't want, if people were able to read between the lines, we don't want Islam over here. We don't want all these other religions. We want one God.
Right.
And he left it a little bit open-ended so he couldn't be accused because, he wasn't specific, but he had just, before he had said that, he had just got done quoting from the epistles of John, which is actually interesting. Check on your own time, read 1 John chapter 4, and it's all about the Antichrist versus Christ, or anti-Christians versus Christians. And Donald Trump right now is representing the Christians, the non-pharisaical Christians, I should say, versus right. The patriotic Christians. That's who he's representing. That's who's really put him in where he's at, and he's doing what he's supposed to be doing. So Donald Trump represents the patriotic Christians, while Hillary Clinton represents the globalists. Anyways, John Lennon here, imagine there's no heaven. It's easy if you try. No hell below us, above us only sky. Imagine all the people living for today. Aha, aha. Or however he says that. Imagine there's no countries. It isn't hard to do. Nothing to kill or die for, and no religion too. Imagine all the people living life in peace. Yoo-hoo-hoo-hoo-hoo, or whatever he does. You may say I'm a dreamer, but I'm not the only one. I hope someday you'll join us and the world will be as one. Imagine no possessions. Now we're getting into communism here, socialism. I wonder if you can. No need for greed or hunger, a brotherhood of man. Imagine all the people sharing all the world. Yoo-hoo-hoo-hoo-hoo. You may say I'm a dreamer, but I'm not the only one. I hope someday you'll join us and the world will live as one.
Sounds wonderful. What's wrong with that?
Yeah. Besides the fact that this is satanic to its core.
Absolutely.
No God, no heaven, or no heaven, no hell, no religion. It's just the religion of man. That's what he's talking about. Man can build his own utopia on earth, get rid of God, get rid of, countries, borders, walls. And this is, again, this is what Trump in this election stands for. A wall. Borders, a nation separate from the world, America first, and one people under God, not imagine if there's no heaven or hell. I mean, that is the lie that was espoused right off the bat in the Garden of Eden by Satan to Adam and Eve, was that they could, basically what he went up to him and said, imagine if you just ate of the tree of knowledge of good and evil, imagine what you could accomplish. Imagine you could become as gods, knowing for yourselves what's good and evil. And so that same lie is at the core root of all false religion, and it's at the core root of globalism. Imagine all the world just joining together, ignore God, we don't need him, you can do it on your own.
Yeah, if I didn't believe that there was a creator, that there was a God, that all sounds wonderful.
Yeah.
But when you know that there is a God, and it's the biblical God, and you realize that that globalism, that peace talk, is all leading down the road to the Antichrist, you understand that it's not a good thing.
But, right.
In and of itself, it sounds wonderful. It's and if you don't believe in God,
right.
Hey, what's wrong with globalism? What's wrong with our worth coming together and being peaceful and everybody having what they need? And, you know, it's so deceiving.
Because who likes war? Who wants war?
Yeah.
I mean, I believe Satan actually causes the wars so that he can have this great cry of peace. And that's why I believe we had World War I, World War II. It was to break down the world. It was to break down the nation states, if you would, and keep consolidating, break them down, build them up, break it down, build it up. And you keep doing that. We might even be in a cycle like that right now. We could be at one last time for a breakdown to build up to the New World Order. I mean, we literally could be looking at World War III. I mean, Russia is very pissed at us right now.
There's a quote that said that Putin actually said, and it was on CNN, I believe, Wolf Blitzer, said that Putin said if Trump gets elected, he thinks that there can be peace, which who knows which way that goes. But if Hillary gets elected, that he said it's almost certain war.
Yeah.
And, you know, we don't want to let Putin dictate
right.
who we vote for, but I think he's making some sense there.
You know, I'm not saying Putin's a good guy or anything, but we got to realize what we're being fed through our media too. I watched videos where Putin was claimed to be a Christian, and he actually was, trying to clean up his nation a little bit. He was actually stood against homosexuality. He called when people would. These gay pride things would come up. He made laws against, homosexual propaganda laws, because he knows that that destroys the nation and destroys the moral fabric of the nation.
Right.
He promoted families to have kids and stuff like that. Now, again, I'm not saying that he's a great guy and everything, but another thing I noticed about him when watching some videos where they showed him talking and they were translating it, he is anti-New World Order. He's an anti-globalist. And I think rumor has it is he kind of played the game all his career that he was for this, and then he got control of Russia, and then he became a nationalist and an anti-globalist. And if that's the case, now you know why Putin would rather have Donald Trump, because Putin doesn't want these international bankers controlling his country, because he's got pride in his country. And Donald Trump's the same. So, and at the same time, you have the Britain pulled out of the European Union not long ago. So it seems like the world system is panicking right now.
Right.
And it's breaking apart.
That's a great point.
So we might have a time of restoration before it comes back again. A lot of people forget about this. But after World War I, you had the League of Nations. That was an attempt at building a global government. That failed. War broke out again. Then you had World War II. Then you had the United Nations. Now, since it's breaking apart again, we might see another war, possibly, and then another attempt at bringing peace to create a global government again. And we don't know if it's going to come to pass or not. You know, a lot of times, Christians in every generation, they always think that theirs is the end time. If you study history, there's always been religious sects that have said, the end's tomorrow, you know, and stuff like that. It could be. But we can't live. Jesus said, no man knows the day or the hour. We have to be ready at all times, and that he will come as a thief in the night where we're not expecting it. We probably won't expect it to come. And then, boom, there it is. But if all we do is live our life saying the end's tomorrow and I'm going to make all these formulas saying when the end's going to be, you're going to be distracted, because Jesus didn't want us to calculate when the end's going to be.
Right.
He wanted us
to live through it.
Yeah. Like a soldier, a regular soldier like we are as Christians, we got a general big picture, but we don't need to know every single detail that God is doing, because he's the general, the ultimate general. We're the soldier. We're trained to perform our tactical missions, which is saving individual souls, helping spread the truth. And, you know, we're not the general. So let's do our part and not try to be the general for God, is my take on that. Since we talked about something, walls and nationalism again, they are the enemy of globalism. And, you know, that's why they're, that's why the Bushes and so forth, that's why they got into the Middle East. I believe they're trying to destabilize the Middle East to break, to take down all the dictators and to try to break down Iran. And we don't like Iran, obviously, but they are trying to resist this New World Order. They don't want to be a part of it. And so the goal there, I believe, was just to try to break apart the Middle East to get Iran sucked up by the international bankers. Therefore, it's just, it's consolidation. Divide and conquer and consolidate. But anyways, walls. New Jerusalem, in Revelation 21, verse 12, it talks about New Jerusalem, New Heavenly Jerusalem, having these great walls. They were 144 cubits tall, which is very tall. Actually, some scholars say that, that the cubit translates to 300 feet. So you have 300-foot walls around New Heavenly Jerusalem. And I look at that as an example of, yeah, you want... Those walls were meant to keep out the undesirables. People, for New Jerusalem, it was the fornicators, the adulterers, the sorcerers, and so forth. And but when I look at that as far as, let's say, how do you apply that to America as a biblical lesson? Well, we should have a wall to keep out those who would like to change our culture, to change our way of life, like the Islamists.
Ones that want to kill us.
And the ones that want to kill us. We don't. A nation is not a nation if it doesn't have borders.
And laws.
And laws. And if they're united together in multiculturalism rather than one people under one God, there's no way it can stay together. It will divide into factions and it will disintegrate. And that's the goal of the globalists. That's why they want mass immigration. They want to change the culture so much. They want to destroy the Christian unification so that they can disintegrate America.
Yeah, that's pretty clear.
Anything you want to add at this point?
No, we've been getting a lot of good comments here and stuff. We are at about an hour.
Okay. Do you want to read any of the comments or any, highlight any of them?
Well, yeah, just a lot of agreement. Where was it?
Well, while you're digging that up, I'm going to just mention again, as far as globalism again, the end game of globalism is this. Satan wants to unify the world, consolidate the world so that he can set up the Antichrist as the king. But ultimately, it's to gather the nations to battle against Christ at the Battle of Armageddon, written about in Revelation 16, verse 14. And Revelation 19, verses 11 through 21, it talks about there Jesus coming back on a white horse and all the nations gathering together to try to fight him, and Jesus basically just slaying the enemies that are trying to do that. So it boils down to this. It's Christ versus Antichrist. And what's amazing is when Donald Trump, again, read from 1 John chapter 4, that's what the epistles of John are all about, the Antichrist versus Christ. And I just thought it was beautiful. It just doesn't seem like a coincidence. You know, he is surrounded by pastors and ministers. People. I mean, the Bible tells us to surround ourselves with good counselors. The book of Proverbs does. It says, he that is wise will surround himself with wise people. That's what Donald Trump has done.
That's what a good business guy does.
Yeah, and a good business guy will do the same. Yeah, so, I mean, very smart. I mean, he's got Ben Carson. You name it. I mean, all these good people, good influencers. And yet we still have these nitpickers, these Pharisees, these, you know, and I'm hard on them because of this. Jesus was hard on the Pharisees. I mean, he went into the temple. He took a whip to them. And so forth. And he taught most of his ministry was against these religious hypocrites. You know what the Pharisees would say about Jesus? Well, that man's a friend of winebibbers and sinners. And, you know, we look at Donald Trump and somebody would say the same thing about him. You know, he's no Jesus, obviously.
No.
But they'd say, well, look at his associations. He's had casinos and this and that. I mean, it just, if Christians would unite for the first candidate that came along presenting the most anti-satanic platform that the Republicans, I think, have ever presented, we would beat Hillary, no problem. So I'm going to say if Hillary Clinton ends up being our president, I believe full-heartedly that the blood of our children could very well literally and spiritually be on your hands, because you have this pettiness, you're vindictive because you think, you know, you just don't like what he said about women in the past and so forth, and you just can't get over that. You can't forgive him, though he's asked for, though he said he's sorry. It reminds me again of the parable where Jesus said, of the unforgiving servant, he said, hey, if you don't forgive people who sin against you, I'm paraphrasing the parable, I'm not going to forgive you, and I'm going to send you to the tormentors because you're a hypocrite. And I feel very strongly about that.
One was your wife was listening.
Oh, so okay.
That's good.
Nicole? Yeah. Or she says Ben Heath, probably.
Yeah. It's under. Okay. But when I talk to people about Trump and politics and things, this is one of the things I bring up, and it was what Crystal said. She said, yes, Trump can be crude. I agree. But he himself is surrounded by Christian people praying for him, which is completely true.
Yeah.
And Hillary and her lies, corruption is very evil, and decades of it. But that's what I believe, that, you know, Trump might not be the best guy as far as the morals of it and the things he's said and the way he's acted and things like that. But I do believe that he will surround himself with people. He right. doesn't want to make all the decisions himself. He doesn't want to control everything.
Right.
Just like he's done in business, he surround himself with good people, good Christian people, and let and in the military, surround himself with good commanders and
right.
and people in charge. And that's how you delegate authority.
Right. That's. I mean, that's what we want for somebody who's qualified
right.
as a president to do that. When you mentioned that, it made me, when we were talking about that, it made me think of some people are accusing us Christian Trump supporters as trusting in man. They'll quote the verse, cursed is he that puts his trust in man. But the thing is most Christians I know, most Trump supporters I know, they're not putting their trust in Donald Trump to do it. They're praying for him, like you were saying. Their families are praying for him. He's got pastors, you know, I mean, they know that Donald Trump can't make America great again. Does he have the skills to do it with God's help? Absolutely. But if he was to come out and not be a friend of Christians and be this pure libertarian, so to speak,
right.
Like a lot of people put their trust in Ron Paul before and things like that. Hey, he had a lot of good things. But when you get too hardcore libertarian, it starts becoming not much different than what Satan promoted in the Garden of Eden. Together we can do it. It's really a different form of one worldism, in a sense. Man building his own utopia. That's what's so unique about Donald Trump is he isn't like that. He's not a pure libertarian.
Right.
I would say he's more close to the biblical form of leader that we've seen, despite being one of the greatest sinners. I mean, I think it's beautiful. And I feel sorry for people who can't see it. It's really sad that they can't see God putting his hand, because I don't think it's not even possible that he could have gotten this far without God's hand being upon him. And I've mentioned it before, but some people, and I might read a transcript of this, I'm very careful about people having dreams and visions, but somebody had a dream, one man in particular, if you Googled it, you'd probably find it, said that God came to him, I think in like 2012, if I remember right, and said that he was going to use Donald Trump. Basically, it was very descriptive of everything that Donald Trump's been doing. He was going to use him to expose corruption, hypocrisy, to give us a restoration even. I hope that's true.
Me too.
And said that he had a heart of a father. He said he may look, this guy's vision, he said that God said that though Donald Trump looks a little brash on the outside and so forth, it says he has the heart of a father, that he really cares about America and loves the people.
He does appear to have a family that's
yeah
pretty intact and got it together. You don't hear a lot about him in the...
Oh, but he's had three wives, Damien.
Well, then, forget it.
Yeah, it's too late for him. He's a sinner.
Yeah. But as kids and stuff, I mean, you can tell a lot about somebody by their kids. And I mean, I don't know everything about him, but
right.
it just seems like he's very family oriented, as
right.
you know, as much as his sin and his faults are.
Loyal too, very loyal.
Yeah.
You know, and that's one very good quality. I mean, God, when you look at the Bible, even if his enemies were loyal to one to another, God respected that. God would look at those qualities and say, well, hey, at least they were loyal. I think, trying to remember, it was the Rechabites or something like that. They were loyal to their father. And it was a good quality that God saw in them. But I was going to say this as well. Donald Trump, I don't know how Christian he is, how far his walk is. I mean, he could be a lot closer than we imagine with who he's surrounded by. But even if he's not that Christian, one thing we can say about him is he's loyal. And he's been a friend of Christians. Christians have helped get him to where he's at. And you better believe he's going to return the favors. He's talked about repealing some laws, the 501c3 and all that, that forbids churches from talking about politics and so forth. I mean, he's promised to get rid of some of that stuff and to free Christian churches and pastors and so forth. I mean, that alone would be enough. That would be like a Cyrus, you know, coming in and maybe not be, if Cyrus was a pagan, but he was a friend of God's people. And that alone would be enough. I mean, at this point in the game with how far America has slipped. I think that's about all I got for tonight. I could go on and on about the wall. We'll probably do that another time.
And we're not, in our discussions, we've talked about this, but we're not all about politics.
Right.
But it just so happens we're 2 weeks away from a critical election.
Right.
It's on our heart.
Yes. If this was about Jeb Bush versus Hillary Clinton or Jeb Bush versus, you know, some other Democrat or something like that, I probably wouldn't be that involved. But since Donald Trump has made this, you know, get the Supreme Court and everything on the line as well. But Donald Trump has made it clear that this is Americanism versus globalism. He's exposed the international bankers. He's exposed the conspiracy of the beast of Revelation 13. That makes it to me this is a spiritual battle. It's not just political elections. Well, I like this candidate's minor policies here and there. These are policies of night and day. This is Christian patriotism versus Satanism. I mean, that's why I look at it this way. And that's why I'm heavily involved this time. And that's why I said, I'm going to spend the next 2 weeks, shoving aside our regular verse-by-verse Bible studies for now and focus on these issues and how they relate to the Bible.
Amen.
All right. Well, hey, thank you for joining us. We'll close in prayer here. Heavenly Father, we want to thank you so much for this time of fellowship that we have with other sincere believers that love America, that love our people, that love their neighbor, but most importantly, they love you. We pray for Donald Trump. We pray that you can continually work on his heart, give him the courage, and help motivate not just his inner campaign and inner circle, but the grassroots, all of us. I mean, we can't expect Donald Trump to do everything for us, even if God's using him. We, Father, we pray that you inspire the people to get out and do what they can to spread the truth, to talk about globalism, to talk about the good things Donald Trump stands for rather than everything the media is trying to make us think of him. And we love you. In Jesus' name, amen.
Amen.
Christian Overcomers is brought to you by the tithes and offerings of our listeners. If you'd like to support our ministry, please go to ChristianOvercomers.com. God bless you, and thank you for your support.
Mine eyes have seen the glory of the coming of the Lord. He is trampling out the vintage where the grapes of wrath are stored. He has loosed the fateful lightning of his terrible sword. His truth is marching.